Welcome back to the Healthcare Uncomplicated YouTube channel. Today I have another guest for you, but before we go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, check all the previous content with other guests and acknowledge our channel partners. And today we have Meg Barron. She is the Vice President of Digital Health Strategy at the American Medical Association. Meg, how are you?
I am doing great. Thank you so much for having me. Excited about this.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for accepting my invite. And we're going to move on to the topic. And today we are here to discuss what's needed for sustainable adoption of digital health. And the first question that I have for you is, what do we need to consider for successful digital health implementation?
Yeah, great question. And just as a bit of context for the team and also organization that I sit within at the AMA, really, this is the task at hand for us is overall, how do we help to make technology an asset versus one more thing or one more burden on the plates of physicians and clinicians and ultimately patients? And there's so much potential here for technology to help really meet and serve some unmet needs in healthcare, as we all know. But at the same time, if not done correctly or rolled out in an efficient manner, it can also have unforeseen consequences as well. So how we like to approach this is, well, what lessons have we learned from the rollout of things like electronic health records, and how do we attempt to right the ship as early stage as possible for all these emerging technology solutions in market today? So where we started, and I joined the team, the digital health team, in 2016-ish timeframe, and when I did join the group, we began doing a baseline digital health benchmark survey. And our goal with this was to really better understand, EHRs aside, what were physicians using then in practice, what they were excited or enthusiastic about using, and then what their key requirements for adoption and really sustainable adoption were. And we took a lot of time even just level setting on a definition for digital health. And again, this is 2016 when primarily EHR usability, health IT, interoperability, those were the main topics of discussion. But now enter, you know, telehealth, e-visits, remote patient monitoring, clinical decision support tools, really wanted to get a sense for current usage, enthusiasm, and key requirements. And the top line from that dating back to 2016 was, the good news, physicians were more enthusiastic than what we expected them to be, especially given frustrations with EHRs. But that enthusiasm was directly tied to a solution's ability to help a physician take better care of patients, have a minute more of time to be able to have FaceTime, either virtual or in person, with patients, and ultimately help them create efficiencies and better quality care. And if it's not doing that automatically, you're competing with the status quo already, right? And then to that end, enthusiasm being there, they were loud and clear about the key requirements that they had in order to not only adopt, but also sustain the adoption of any digital health technology or solution. And those key requirements are, prove to me it works and has an evidence base. Prove to me that there is a fair payment pathway or that I'll get reimbursed, right, if I'm using this or prescribing this and then at a fair rate. The third around liability coverage. So who's going to be liable if I use this app, technology, whatnot in practice, especially from a privacy and security standpoint. And then lastly, and this is where we spend a lot of our time, is really just the change management of introducing anything new into an already overburdened workflow. And for a bit of context there, you know, physicians on average and other, you know, care team members, you've got upwards of 4,000 clicks a day in electronic health record, right? So when you hear some startups or companies say, well, it's just two more clicks and then ... like here's a nominal return you can expect. You almost hear laughter at times from some physicians of, well, that's just not going to work, right? Help talk me through clicks that you're going to help save me, or time that you're going to help save me, or outcomes that you're going to help produce for me, right? That is really where is the juice worth the squeeze for this. So those four key requirements have really been foundational to our strategy overall, but really remain true. And when we've repeated this baseline research, both in 2019 and released the results about a month before COVID, and then we just did the latest iteration of this research in 2022, those key requirements have really remained the same, like meaning those four key buckets. If anything, the need for things like privacy and security and a level of confidence in things like privacy and security, as well as that efficient path to streamline the workflow, have only increased in terms of requirements across the board.
Brilliant. Meg, thank you so much. It is so much. It's fascinating, so much to cover there.
Yeah.
In the zone. And moving on, the next question is, how are you seeing digital health evolving?
Yeah, I think, you know, as we've all talked about, the silver lining for the pandemic, of course, was that digital health really got pushed to the main stage, right? It's not that it wasn't getting utilized at all, but to the degree that it had the potential to get used, of course, the pandemic really helped to push that forward. And some, again, context or just stats as it relates to that, we saw, you know, over 50% of physicians use telehealth for the first time during the pandemic, right? And we looked at a lot of perspectives from physicians in all different practice settings, all different specialties, all different age ranges to really get a sense for what they were enjoying about things like telehealth and remote patient monitoring, especially given their just recent or first time use with that. And then the same thing from a patient perspective. So we actually did some research with MITRE, Mayo, a number of other collaborators that really looked at both sides of the coin for this. And back to enthusiasm, I mean, the enthusiasm there on both sides. Again, as you think about requirements for adoption or really sustainable adoption, that's where these pieces, as it relates to reimbursement or having reimbursement stay at an equal playing field of in-person care, really come into play. I think now the topic at hand and what we spend a lot of time focused on is what's that magic blend of in-person and virtual care? And we speak to this often as digitally enabled care, right? With recognition that there's a time and a place for virtual, there's a time and a place, of course, for in-person care, but what's that secret sauce in the middle of if this, then that, and providing options both for physicians, for clinicians, and of course, for patients to be able to access care in the way that they need to, want to, for the best outcomes.
Brilliant. And you mentioned the standards before in the first question. Now moving on, can you tell us more about the American Medical Association standards and best practices around digital health?
Yeah. So a few things related to that. One, and this dates back, you know, as far as 2017, 2018 timeframe, but in recognition that a lot of the emerging technologies, solutions, apps that were coming down the pipe, most of them fell outside of the scope of the FDA and the bandwidth of the FDA. So American Medical Association with American Heart Association, with Mayo, with HIMSS, with the Consumer Technology Association, App Association, a number of different organizations came together to say, well, what's the role or opportunity that we have to help develop guidance for the industry in this space, really around the topic areas of privacy, data security, interoperability, usability, efficacy, right? What guidance can we as an industry help to provide? And this can get complex at times because if it's not regulated, you've got this kind of carrot versus stick approach of A, you need the vendors to recognize and appreciate the guidance that kind of table stakes they should be following to help have the highest likelihood of success. And often, though, you as a company would be looking at that from the perspective of how is this going to help me be differentiated in market, right, if I follow this guidance. On the flip side, for those that are the purchasers of these solutions or technologies, be that health systems, practices, large employers, payers, it's what are the table stake expectations or key questions that I should be asking? So that entity was called Exertia. It's X-C-E-R-T-I-A. HIMSS has actually taken over the infrastructure support for Exertia guidance, and that guidance is open source. So that's freely available to all out there. In addition to that guidance that's there, AMA has put out some principles for, you know, optimal both care as well as for companies to be able to follow as kind of a roadmap of sorts around privacy and security. So there's a resource called Privacy by Design that the AMA has put out, and that target audience is largely the vendor community in terms of key criteria they should be thinking through to help ensure their solutions are following the right guidance set. The last guidance set that I would mention is around innovation and equity. So we have a focus for our entire organization and a division that's focused around the Center for Health Equity. And as part of that work, we have put out with a number of different collaborators some innovation and equity principles. And really what these are focused on is how do we help to ensure that solutions, technologies are designed with the most marginalized patients in mind, right? And also the most marginalized physicians, providers, and clinicians in mind as well, so that your likelihood of success or your likelihood of stickiness in terms of product market fit can be as optimal as possible. Brilliant. One last thing, if you'll allow me, I'll just layer in. Sure. We have collaborations with a number of different health tech accelerators, incubators, of course, around the receiving end of a lot of questions from companies of, I would love to get more physician feedback or involvement or other key industry stakeholder involvement in what I'm building, or at times just looking for a pulse check on if they're on the right path or not, mm-hmm. right? And also at times pilot sites, or they're looking for a clinician or a physician advisor to get involved in what they're doing. So we were playing a lot of manual matchmaker in years past for this exact reason of helping to connect physicians and health tech companies across the country. So we needed a way to scale that. So we built a platform called Physician Innovation Network, which really serves as more of a match.com to connect physicians and health tech companies all across the country. And we've got nearing 20,000 users on that platform yeah. now, which I'd say about a third are physicians. And again, all different practice settings, different age ranges. And then the rest are startups, participants from larger organizations, VCs, and so on. So that is mission driven. That is free for companies, free for physicians to participate in. And you know, we'd welcome for you to join that.
Brilliant, fantastic. Meg, repeat that again for the audience to get the snip of what is the name? The
Sure, yeah. It's AMA Physician Innovation Network.
Physician Innovation Network. That's yeah. cool. Meg, you mentioned so much. I mean, you're doing an amazing work in terms of shaping up the industry from standards to best practices. Some things are new. The guidance around cybersecurity from interoperability. You mentioned so much. And the industry really needs that kind of not just the pushing forward, but the bringing together all these mm-hmm. because is so much to consider, challenges mm-hmm. and best practices, and things are evolving so fast.
Yeah.
Brilliant. We could talk for hours. We come to the end of the interview. I have one last little question.
Of course.
For you, which is probably a bit of a surprise for you. It's related to the channel. How can we make healthcare uncomplicated?
Uncomplicated?
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah. Multi-billion-dollar question. Right? Well, I am a massive believer in the power of collaboration and partnerships. And I think now more than ever, especially coming out of a pandemic, that will be essential. And as we think about the potential for both existing key institutional partners, such as health systems and practices, large employers, payers, to partner with and collaborate with new entrants to healthcare or emerging technologies or models of care, I think there is endless opportunity there. I think we have to continue to come back to those principles for both the most marginalized of patients and most marginalized of physicians and providers that are out there, as well as those key requirements that are needed for adoption and market. But one last thing I would note is we recently worked with Manat Health and then 40 plus contributors, collaborators to this effort on a resource called The Future of Health and the Digital Health Disconnect. And really what this is a blueprint for the industry to consider how do we go about optimally really bringing to life digitally enabled care. And digitally enabled care is not just in-person and virtual working just in parallel or on parallel paths. It's really how do we optimize in-person and virtual care for the most optimal results that equate to improved access, that equate to improved outcomes, improved physician and patient satisfaction. And then of course, bottom line wise, how do we create better ROI across the board for healthcare? So we know that's absolutely needed. And inclusive of that is a framework around how to measure and quantify the value of integrating new technologies.
Brilliant. Meg, thank you so much for congratulations on your amazing work, what you're doing in the industry, the collaborations and everything. And what a great way to round up the power of collaboration, because the industry, and we are seeing that now, we're seeing quite a lot of collaboration, partnerships with big organizations, small and medium sizes. So thank you so much for accepting my invite and having
you so much. And thanks for the work that you're doing and really the platform as well.
Thank you, Meg. I'm going to round up now. To all our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, I'm going to post Meg's socials in here, the LinkedIn and socials, Twitter, and also the American Medical Association links. Make sure you connect with Megan, ask her questions, and feel free to collaborate, of course, and find some strategic partnerships. And I'll see you all next time.